reading these tickets. Look at these. Just reading them. Steinemite, also featuring Michael Coren. Anyway, we have 5 tickets to give away, and they're not cheap. They're $60 each. We're giving 5 away. Email us, thearena@sunmedia.ca. Just briefly, why you really like The Arena. Don't give me an essay, just a paragraph or so. If you really hate The Arena, then you need to write to care of Peter Mansbridge, cbc.com, or something like that. Okay, we usually have her here on Monday, but being Easter, Chris was away converting heathens to Christ, or something like that. So instead, Chrisanity on a Tuesday. Chris Sims, welcome to you.
Oh, thank you very much, Michael.
And let's begin with the death of manhood out in Alberta. I think he's 43-year-old minister in the PC government had a confrontation with a 67-year-old retired man dying of liver cancer. Explain all, please.
I wish I could, Michael. I actually had to go back and reread it because I thought I was missing something there. You've got this, it looks terrible. The optics on this are awful. You've got some 40-something-year-old man, as you said, and in my estimation, looking at him, he looks able-bodied and quite fit. He purposefully picks out a house with not one but 2 Wild Rose campaign signs out front with his long hair and trendy sweater and then says, "The 67-year-old man assaulted me." Does that gain you votes in Alberta? Because I'm from out west, I'm not from Alberta, but that wouldn't go over so well with your constituents very often. And also this whole attacking the Reform Party thing, saying that as some sort of derisive comment, oh, Wild Rose is full of reformers. You do know you're in Alberta, right?
Well, apparently they've paid enormous amounts of money to a downtown Toronto, how shall I put this without being sued, interesting man who's running the PC campaign. But I mean, this particular incident is terrific because, like, it seems to me the 67-year-old retired guy who's sadly dying with liver cancer might be a rather, irascible old fella. However, he's known as a Wild Rose supporter. There, as you say, 2 signs on the front of his house. The candidate has apparently been there before, knows not to go again. He goes there. There's a confrontation. We have some on video. Nothing much seems to happen. But then the PC minister candidate actually tweets the media, calls the police. He believes he'll get bonus points as the victim of a man 25 years older than him who's on his deathbed. I mean, who's told them to do this, for goodness sake?
I would love to know because, you know, Winston Churchill is a very famous and very loved politician, and this is hardly Churchillian behavior. You're looking to people, to candidates, especially male candidates, to be, you know, forthwith and stand up for what's right and to frankly be a little bit brave. And complaining about a 67-year-old man giving a bop saying him, you know, get off my lawn, so to speak, and then actually calling in the cavalry, the media, the police officers, and saying, you know, he assaulted me. Yeah. Boy, oh boy, I've seen something similar actually up here on the Hill. It was a Liberal member of Parliament who had a Conservative member of Parliament, Michael, put his hand on his shoulder once. He came out to the pool mics and said, "I was just assaulted in the House of Commons." And grabbed his face.
Who was it? Who was the Liberal MP?
I'm sorry, but that was Mr. David McGuinty. He's a very kind man, but man, he came out and said this, and it's like, do you really think you're gaining votes by doing this?
I don't know if he is a kind man or not. Yeah, but you're right about Churchill. It's more Chihuahua than Churchill, of course. But the person who's running the campaign might enjoy having a man put his hand on his shoulder, but I should shut up and move on. Now, Fidel Castro, that old fascist, Fidel Castro, who for years now has put dissidents in prison, Christians in prison, people should realize this, people with AIDS. Having AIDS is a crime in Cuba. They're put in prison too, so deeply homophobic, great friend of Che Guevara, who will become sexually aroused when he saw people being murdered. This man, who is now completely gaga, has criticized Stephen Harper and Canada. Trudeau, he said, was brilliant, but Stephen Harper he's not so keen on. I think that's marvelous.
I didn't know that about AIDS victims. That's awful.
Yeah.
Wow. I knew they couldn't have, you know, freedom of assembly or freedom of press or all those sort of newfangled things we have here, but really, this came out of left field, so to speak. And I don't know where this came from. In fact, I can't remember a time that the Prime Minister, our Prime Minister, has ever even uttered Fidel Castro's name. We do $1 billion worth of business with them every year. We did last year. And so there's, you know, the plain old small e economic relationship. But as far as, you know, interpersonal things, I've never heard anything from Harper on him. And yet he attacks him and then compares him to Trudeau, saying they're nothing like each other, as if that's news to anyone.
Yeah. And I mean, what he means is Pierre Trudeau was prepared to embrace physically and politically and metaphorically all sorts of dictators throughout the world, turned a blind eye to death camps, concentration camps throughout the Soviet bloc, China and Cuba. And Stephen Harper says, sorry, I'm not really into that sort of oppression. I don't like it. That's the difference.
And also, Castro, apparently, his portrait or photograph was all around the Trudeau family home. It wasn't just a thing for cameras. Apparently, he held the infant Trudeau boys when they were babies, and he gave them nicknames, and it was a very warm and fuzzy relationship. And did you notice, Michael, that he went after Her Majesty the Queen as well?
Really?
Yes, and said that we were basically puppets of Her Majesty, and therefore, you know, the Brits might as well join the Union of Americas because he's not allowed to. It was this constant railing, and I couldn't come up with an actual, you know, sentient reason or understandable reason why he would do this, so I came up with a joke that perhaps Mr. Castro has now seen The Iron Lady, the film, because it's out on DVD now,
yeah.
And it reminded him about how mad he was over the Falklands, because he brings that up. He brings up the Falkland Islands and the fact that Britain defended its own colony. It's absolutely bizarre.
Well, yeah, I mean, I'm not really even a colony, for goodness sake. Most Brits had
territory.
No, yeah, right. We didn't even know where it was. I was in Britain at the time. General Galtieri, an alcoholic old fascist, who was in charge of a dictatorship that, by coup, ruled Buenos Aires in Argentina. Odious regime, it stank in every way. And he had all sorts of people in prison. He then invaded the Falklands to try and get some support in his home country, and the Falkland Islanders said, we don't want this to happen. But it does fascinate me that God must have woken up lately, because Chavez, Mugabe and Castro were all about to die quite soon. Thank you, Lord. Thank you.
They're all coming up at the same time. Again, I don't know why it's come up, and to be clear, nothing's come from the Harper team on this. I sent them a thing saying, sorry to bother you, but do you care that Fidel Castro said this about you? I'm sure he's already clipped it out for his scrapbook.
Oh,
it's bizarre.
Sure. Well, before you go, you're a bit of a theologian. With all these old buggers like Mugabe and Castro and Chavez dying, is there room in hell for them all, or will hell have to expand somewhere?
I'm not so sure. I'm going to have to contact and call a friend, Brian Lilly. He's much better on issues of hell and purgatory, and get back to you.
Okay, you do that. As ever, a great pleasure. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Michael.